Hi, everybody. Thank you for coming today to the MiSoC special session on mental health and human capital. I would like to just make two brief apologies before we start. And one is that the fifth talk of this session, the effect of grading on child well-being by Tine Eriksen, is not going to go on because Tine, unfortunately, couldn't be here today. And along those lines, there is also, we have a substitute for Sonia Bhalotra. Paulino will be presenting Sonia's paper because, again, Sonia had some health issues and she couldn't be present today. So with that in mind, we still have four talks to go through, so it's going to be a packed session, and I will be trying to keep everybody on time. So thank you, and now we have John with Depression for Economists. Cheerful.
Okay. Hi, everybody. So, depression is the second leading cause of disease burden worldwide. This is from the 2010 study. And the cross-sectional prevalence of depression is about 4 to 5%. That is, at any point in time, about 4 to 5% of the population are suffering from major depressive disorder, and about 13% of us will experience it at some point in our lives. The economic cost has been estimated to be about 76 billion euros per year in Europe, about 31 billion in the US. And the basic claim of this paper is that, many economists and many social scientists have studied depression. Our claim is that actually applying the kind of the basic tools of economic analysis and economic theory to study depression is something that's both worthwhile and useful. It's something that economists should do. And that what I'm going to show you today is that a very simple model of a decision maker who's just learning about one parameter, that's the returns to her effort, can rationalize many of the core symptoms of depression. I think it's a helpful way to think about depression. It's consistent with some of the psychological evidence, and I think it's something that economists should think about. We should put it into our models where relevant. So what does this paper do? In a nutshell, we set up a very simple model in which there's a decision maker who's learning over time about an uncertain parameter, and that parameter is the returns to her labor effort. She experiences some bad shock to her income, and that leads her to update that belief and form a pessimistic belief about her ability, the returns to effort. Then, as a result of that belief, she rationally withdraws from various activities. So she's going to withdraw labor effort if she thinks the returns are low. She's going to withdraw from other behaviors that are complementary to labor effort. That's also going to lead to slower learning in future about those returns. And as a result, she can get stuck in a persistent depression, what you might call a poverty trap. You experience a shock, you become pessimistic, and it takes a long time to unlearn that shock. So that's the nutshell of the model, and I'm just going to walk you through both some evidence and then some simple theory that works through these ideas. And I want to, before I even begin with that, just make two caveats. The first thing is that throughout the talk I'm going to hold preferences fixed. So there are some symptoms of depression, things like anhedonia, the loss of pleasure in everyday activities, that are not well rationalized by the beliefs model that I'm going to present. We're going to put that aside, but I think that's something useful for future work. And this is also going to look like an ultra-rational model of depression, in that learning is going to be fully Bayesian and in some sense fully rational. That's going to give me the right qualitative predictions for behavior, which is all that I need for today's talk. But we're not claiming that we should think about depression in a fully rational choice framework. I would expect that quantitatively Bayesian learning is going to be unable to fit the kinds of long spells of depression that we see amongst people, and that a non-Bayesian model that maintains the qualitative predictions might do a better job of fitting quantitatively the data. But we're not going to go there today. Okay, so before I go into economics, just a very quick primer on some psychology. So Aaron Beck is in some sense the founding father of the cognitive theory of depression, and the basic focus of that theory is on distorted thoughts as the source of depression and major depressive disorder. There's this idea of Beck's cognitive triad, which is that you form negative beliefs about yourself, about the world, and about the future. And that's going to be ultimately what our model looks like. He divides the symptoms. He took a large group of depressed people and tried to categorize the symptoms that they suffered from and puts them into four categories. The cognitive symptoms, which you can basically summarize as being about pessimistic beliefs about yourself and your ability to change the world and to change your circumstances and your future. The motivational symptoms, that's kind of withdrawal from activities, both pleasurable activities and productive activities, dependency on others, paralysis of the will and decision and so forth. Emotional symptoms, so dejected mood, reduced gratification, negative feelings about yourself, delusions of poverty, feelings of worthlessness and kind of extreme hallucinations as well. We're going to add into those, there's a probably many of you know, the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual is the kind of the Bible for how practitioners think about mental health issues. And we're going to take some additional symptoms. So these four categories largely fit into what the DSM-5, the most recent issue, sets out. But we're going to take a couple of additional symptoms from there, which is the somatic symptoms. We're going to focus on weight loss or weight gain, which commonly follow from depressive episodes, and also increasing or decreasing the amount of sleep. So some very basic correlational evidence. I'm not going to claim that these graphs should be interpreted causally, but they're consistent with the patterns of behavior that we're then going to generate in the model. So the data we have here are taken from the Indonesia Family Life Survey, which is a panel data set which includes, importantly for us, a measure called the CESD, which is a survey measure that tries to capture kind of how severely depressed people are. So higher scores here mean more depressed, and I apologize if you forget the exact scale in this survey. But kind of curiously, we flipped the axes here. So the model is going to make a causal claim from depression to behavior, but I've got behaviors on the x-axis and depression on the y-axis here. But what we see here is that more depressed people supply less labor hours in this survey. More depressed people have lower total household expenditures. And then there's a kind of U-shaped relationship, maybe if you squint a bit at this graph, there's a kind of U-shaped relationship between depression and body mass. So there's kind of depressed people tend to have lower than average or higher than average body mass index, kind of consistent with what DSM-5 sets out. And sleep duration is a strong U-shaped relationship between sleep duration and depression. So depressed people tend to sleep less than average or more than average. So how does the model work? We're going to think about a very simple model of decision making. It's really a one period model that's repeated over time, and the only dynamic element is the learning about yourself. So there's a decision maker who has a quasi-linear utility function that depends on C, which is just all consumption goods, food consumption F, and sleep consumption S. And it's going to be linear in consumption, and then there's going to be concave functions phi and psi for food and sleep. And we're going to assume that those functions are concave, and they're both increasing up to some point, and then they're decreasing beyond that bliss point. So the idea is that it's nice to consume more food up to a point, and then it becomes displeasurable. It's nice to sleep a lot up to some point, and at some point it's actually not that fun to spend your whole day sleeping. So we're going to this kind of a utility maximizing level of food consumption FC and a utility maximizing level of sleep consumption FS, which are the bliss points of those two functions. And then there's a budget constraint, and the budget constraint is that your total expenditure on consumption goods and on food depends on this function, which has two parts. So the first part in square brackets here, this is the kind of labor effort choice. So labor effort is a binary variable. You either exert effort or you don't. If you exert effort, then you receive a return A. And if you don't exert effort, then you receive a return A bar, which you could think of as kind of some subsistence activity or just a routine task or unemployment insurance or something like that. It's something with a known return. So A bar is going to be common knowledge, but A is uncertain. You don't know precisely what the return is to your labor effort. And then the second part, this part in square brackets here, I'm going to call that effective labor supply, and it's a function of how much you eat and how much you sleep. So the idea is that, you know, if you eat very little and you sleep very little, you're kind of, it's going to be hard for you to work productively. But similarly, if you sleep too much, then there's a few hours left in the day, and if you eat too much, then there's morbidity and there's going to be reduced capacity to work. So these two, this kind of capital phi and capital psi function, again, going to be concave with a kind of maximizing point, which is an intermediate level. And you're going to bundle we're going to bundle these together and call those effective labor units. And later in the paper, I won't show today, but later in the paper, we add other kind of other choices to that function as well. And probably you can see straight away that everything in this production function is complementary to this belief that you have about your return to effort, this capital A. So if you think that you're more productive, you're going to be more likely to exert labor effort, but it's also going to increase the return to maximizing these two functions. So it's going to push you towards the production maximizing food and sleep choices as well. So how does learning work in this model? Well, the decision maker is not going to observe they're not going to observe every element of this function. They're simply going to observe their total income, which depends on the known labor supply choice and the unknown labor productivity, on the known effective labor supply choice and an unknown shock, epsilon, which is unknown to be Gaussian. So then the belief is going to be that capital A is equal to mu, and then the expectation of income at some point in time, it takes this following form, and it's a standard signal extraction problem. So I observe my income, and I need to figure out what part of that income was driven by the unobserved shock, epsilon, and what part of that income was driven by my productivity parameter, A. So a very large negative shock to epsilon is going to make me negatively update my belief about my productivity. I'm going to infer that some of that negative shock was driven by low productivity. Does that make sense to everybody? So we're going to identify depression as simply being a negative shock to mu. You become more pessimistic about the returns to your effort. And you can think of that kind of in two ways. It could be that previously you were over-optimistic and then mu decreased, or it could be that previously you had rational beliefs and now you kind of have incorrectly negatively biased beliefs. The qualitative predictions are going to be the same either way, but kind of the efficiency considerations will be different depending on whether your beliefs are correct or incorrect. And like I kind of hinted at the beginning, we don't require kind of biased beliefs or non-Bayesian updating to get the qualitative predictions that we're going to make. It's not that we don't think those things are important, but a Bayesian model is going to deliver everything we're learning today. And it's also not clear that all depression episodes need to be kind of in quote unquote irrational. So if your plant shuts down, or you know there's recent work on how competition in the goods market from cheap overseas imports leads people to become more depressed. They kind of fear for their future career prospects and so forth. Well, in some sense, that's a rational negative update to mu, and in some sense, it's kind of rational to become more pessimistic about your future outcomes. So let's do the comparative statics of this model. So effort choice is a very simple decision. I should say that in the core model, we assume that people are not they're not making choices with a view to learning. So it's common in these dynamic belief formation models that in some sense you don't anticipate the effect of your decisions on future learning. That's important here because if I choose to exert low effort, I'm going to stop learning about the returns to effort. So even somebody who has a very pessimistic belief about A might, in a fully dynamic model, choose to exert effort to try to learn more about A. We're going to shut that down and simply assume that you exert effort if you believe that return to effort is greater than the return to the kind of known outside option, production. I don't think that the fully rational, fully dynamic optimization would change the qualitative prediction here. What that means is that if you experience a sufficiently negative shock to mu, you'll withdraw your labor effort, and you can get inefficiently low effort if you believe that your return to effort is lower than A bar, but in fact it's higher than A bar. So you form a very pessimistic belief about yourself, which is incorrect, then you're going to inefficiently withdraw labor supply. The food and sleep choice, well, because I have these two concave functions, there's a kind of concave utility from food with a bliss point and a concave production production possibilities effect of food with another bliss point. The choice that you make is going to lie somewhere between those two optima. There's a trade-off. So you could think that maybe consumption-wise you would like to sleep a lot, but that's not very good for your job, so you get up early in the morning and stagger into the office. If you experience a negative shock to your belief about the return to effort, that production motive becomes less important because you expect that getting into the office early is not going to have that much effect on your future earnings, and so you might find that you are less likely to get out of bed. again, I'm not claiming that people are kind of making some rational choice, oh, I'm going to sleep in two more hours because I'm depressed now. But kind of deep down, this kind of loss, paralysis of the will or loss of motivation is going to be captured by this pessimism about your returns. So you experience a negative shock to mu, the production motive becomes less important, and what you're going to do is to move towards your consumption, whatever that kind of consumption optimum is, and that could be higher or lower than the production optimum. And so some people will increase how much they eat and sleep, and some people will decrease it. This makes two falsifiable predictions. The first is that if I can pre-classify people as being over or under sleepers or over or under eaters, people are going to move kind of away from that kind of, with respect to the production optimum, people are going to move away from that production optimum when they become depressed. So in principle, I could predict who it is that's going to respond to depression by eating more and who it is that's going to respond by eating less. A couple more correlations from the data. We also see a strong negative relationship between depression and expenditure on education, and a strong positive relationship between depression and expenditure on tobacco. So you can put those into the model and thinking about temptation goods such as drugs and alcohol, which are goods which are bad for your production motives but good for consumption motives, and investment goods which are good for production motives and bad for consumption because you have to take money out of consumption and put it into education. Well, if I decrease the importance of production motives by reducing my belief about the returns to effort, then I will naturally increase my expenditure on temptation goods and decrease my expenditure on investment goods. So you get those predictions out of the model as well. And like I say, it's a super simple model that you form one belief, everything else is complementary to that belief, and you move in the direction predicted by that complementarity. Just a couple of interesting kind of theoretical features of learning in this model. So this is the posterior belief that you hold after observing your income. It has two interesting parts. The first is the relative importance of the variance of this, your kind of belief about the variance of the shock epsilon and your belief about the variance of the variance of your posterior about your productivity. So the higher is your, so the lower is your belief about the variance of the shock. In some sense, the less important you think that fate, kind of chance and kind of nature dealing you bad outcomes is, the more strongly you're going to update in response to a shock. So if in some sense you think that everything is in your control and you experience a very bad outcome, you're going to infer from that you have very low A. And that's consistent with psychological evidence that the kinds of shocks that typically lead to depression are stresses that people believe they have control over. So it's things like job loss and relationship breakdown more than things like bereavement, for example. Another feature is that when you become depressed, you decrease this effective labor supply, you kind of make less productively optimal sleep and food choices, and that scales up the variance of the shock and it slows down your future learning. So you experience a depression shock and it actually takes you longer to get out of it than it took you to get into it. And in the kind of extreme cases where you become so depressed that you withdraw your labor effort completely and learning ceases. And at that point you stop learning and you could become stuck in a poverty trap where you have kind of persistent beliefs that your returns are lower than they truly are. And some related theory with similar features. So to sum up, negative income shock leads you to hold more pessimistic beliefs about your returns to effort. Leads you to withdraw labor effort, make less productively optimal food and sleep choices, to increase temptation good expenditure and decrease investment good expenditure. It lowers overall consumption and also expected future consumption kind of naturally because you expect to be less productive in the future and there's a potential poverty trap. And I just finally want to touch on kind of treatment. So the kind of leading treatment these days for depression is cognitive behavioral therapy, kind of developed by Skinner in the 80s. It has a focus on kind of the cognitive side of depression. It's the most commonly used and most commonly studied treatment for depression. So about of 189 RCTs that Haushofer identified, 111 of them study CBT. And crudely, you can summarize CBT as targeting two things: your distorted thoughts, in our model that's mu, and your distorted behaviors, which in our model are labor supply, food, and sleep. So in some sense, this therapy exactly ties into how the theory works, that it's targeting the parts of behavior and the parts of your beliefs that we think are kind of off because of depression. So to wrap up, we have a very simple model, but we think it's useful. It fits many of the diverse behaviors of depressed people. And central to the model is this complementarity between beliefs about yourself and the behaviors that flow from those beliefs. It fits well with how kind of cognitive behavioral therapy works. But outside the model are things like these emotional symptoms, anhedonia, just loss of pleasure in everyday activities, is not well captured by this model, so the utility function has been held fixed throughout. You could imagine another model in which you learn about your preferences, so you experience some shock to utility, and that leads you to become more pessimistic about your ability to generate future flows of utility. I think it would have many of the same features as this theory. I think quantitatively, to get this model to fit data, you would need to have a role for non-Bayesian updating. If you think about someone who's been working for 45 years and they experience one job loss event, it's hard to imagine a Bayesian making such an extreme update on that event that they drop out of the labor market entirely. But that's not in the paper either. And that's all I have to say.
I was wondering, the model is really about like your ability and so it's really about stressors in the labor market, and as you mentioned, there are many stressors. We think that, you know, depression can come from many other dimensions of life. And in the same time, if you think of like the models of health that we have, the traditional models, this is really something very different, right, than what we've seen in traditional models of health. So I was just wondering if you guys thought about other talk a little about how did you get this dimension?
So really, I mean, we took the symptoms off the shelf and we thought, what's the... These look to us like somebody who's become pessimistic about what their ability is to influence their future outcomes. And the kind of the natural way for a quite mainstream economist like me, at least, to think about that is through the labour market. But like I say, I think I completely agree with you that there's... I referred to things like relationship breakdown. That doesn't fit naturally into this model, but you could easily imagine a richer model in which you have beliefs about your ability to influence your life outcomes in general. You experience a bad outcome and you become more pessimistic about your ability to create good outcomes in the future, and I think that would fit many of these predictions just the same. It would be somewhat more complicated to write down. So we took the simplest model that we could write, but we're not claiming that this is the right model or the final model in any sense.
Josh Kinsler and Ronni Pavan, and it's still quite preliminary, so take all the results and the sort of findings with probably more than a pinch of salt. But what we want to investigate here is the effect of maternal emotional well-being. We're going to use maybe different terms to define this, and various aspects of child development. In terms of the motivation of this study is, we know that there are many studies in very various disciplines that analyze the impact of maternal well-being, or if you want, depression, on different aspects of child development. And there are some studies, fewer and concentrated maybe in the psychological literature or clinical medicine, that analyze the impact of children's attributes, if you think of, for example, ADHD, on maternal well-being. So they analyze the sort of opposite direction of causality, if you want. And obviously, we are all very familiar with the literature that stresses the importance of looking at child development in a sort of kind of encompassing way, and looking at the development of children, cognitive as well as non-cognitive skills, and looking at the complementarities and the sort of self-productivity of these skills and so on. Which obviously refers to the work by Kunya Heckman and Shenak. So now we relate to these literatures, in various sort of disciplines, various fields, mainly in the, you know, when it comes to the economic sort of structure, the model structure to the model by Heckman and others. And we try to contribute to this literature by asking two questions. The first question is whether a maternal well-being is itself influenced by aspect, you know, by the way children develop. So if there is that kind of second or reverse kind of causation there that we should be aware of and that we should model. And then we sort of ask a question that is more related to the measurement issues of children on cognitive skills, and namely the fact that maternal well-being may influence what are the measures that we have of children development. And we're going to call it this, in inverted quotes, reporting bias. So a lot of these contributions are possible because we have a fairly rich set of data. And we're going to use in this study from the Millennium Court study, which interviews mothers about their mental health at different points in time during the development of the child. So we have time-varying measures of maternal mental health or well-being, if you want to call it like that, and obviously measures that vary over time about cognitive and non-cognitive aspects of child development. So we have, you know, these kind of fundamental, you know, sort of data. And we can estimate, therefore, a three-dimensional production function with children's skills, cognitive and non-cognitive on one side, and maternal non-cognitive skills on the other side. Sorry, sort of together in some sense in a system of equation, and investigate the importance of these feedback effects. What we're going to see in the estimation is that the magnitude, at least as far as we can tell right now with the sort of, you know, initial sort of attempt to estimate this model, that the magnitude of this feedback effect is going to be quite small, just to give you a preview. The second contribution stems from the fact that in talking about all these issues, it's always occurred to me, and I guess to many of us, that a lot of the non-cognitive skills that we observe for the children are very often mother-reported. In other words, the mothers are asked questions about the emotional, social behavior of the child. The typical example is the strength and difficulty questionnaire. And, you know, it is the mother that answers. Typically the mother, it could be obviously the father, but in sort of 85% of the cases in these kind of surveys, it's the mother that reports the social and emotional skills of the child. So the question arises, if we think that maternal well-being is one of the inputs of the production function of children's skills, but at the same time is also something that affects the way these skills are reported, are the associations that we're going to find between maternal well-being and children outcomes just the fruit of this kind of measurement issue? And I think it is an important question that, you know, so far has received little attention in the literature. And, you can find lots of examples. I mean, you can think of mothers that maybe perhaps suffer from depression. They have a difficult period of time, and for whatever reasons, and then they obviously could view the behavior of their children as a bit more problematic than the average mother. And what we're going to do is to make use of another useful feature of the MCS, which is that we, through the survey, we have information about the children's non-cognitive skills that are not reported by the mother, but are instead reported by the interviewer, and sometimes reported by the teachers. This is important because what will show you that once we sort of kind of account for this kind of maternal reporting bias on the children's non-cognitive skills by using these other measures, then we'll see that some of the parameters of the production function of child development actually change quite a bit. And in particular, that children's non-cognitive skills will be shown to be less persistent than in models where we do not take into account this reporting bias. Now, this is not to say that teachers' observations or interviewers' observations are objective, perfect observations of the children's non-cognitive skills. Don't you know, let's not make that assumption, that is not the assumption we're making, but simply that whatever are the factors, I mean, teachers may be, you know, there is obviously, I know there is also a lot of literature about teachers' biases and things like those, but whatever those biases in, say, the teacher's evaluation of the child, we need to assume that these are not inputs in the production function of children on cognitive skills. So that is the assumption that we're making. Not that these are perfect measures, but they're not, you know, very significant inputs in the production function of children's skills. So just a brief overview of the literature, if I may. Pointing out the contribution that others obviously have made in this field. We're not the first people that by any means are looking at the effect of maternal, mental health or well-being on children outcomes. I mean, never would dream of planning anything like that. There are plenty of very interesting studies. One of them is also a study that will be, some of them will be presented today, obviously. There is a literature out there. I would say it's quite, it's some exception, probably relatively recent. And so this is a topic that is sort of expanding right now. And we have, also a little bit more in epidemiological literature about this kind of different sort of channel of causation, what we call the feedback effect, where perhaps less has been said. And there is an interesting paper about the measurement error in child non-cognitive skill by Steve Putney and others that is very interesting, because there they have some kind of objective or, assessment of the child non-cognitive skills, if you want, or psychological state by experts, basically, by psychologists and so on. But that paper looks at data. I mean, the data is only cross-sectional, so it cannot analyze the development of these skills over time and things like those. So I'm going to skip on the description of the sample. Perhaps most of you know the Millennium Course study in this audience. I just say a couple of things. We're looking at children from the age of 3, when these skills are, easier to measure in some sense. At age 9, we have some measurements, but it's a bit difficult to know what is cognitive, what is non-cognitive at age 9, at least in my mind anyway. So we look at data from age 3 to age 11, so the sort of preschool, primary school years, where we think maternal and parental influences are going to be more dominant. And we have about in excess of 10, depending on the sample and missing data and so on, about 10,000 children. Going to go again a little bit fast on this. So we measure children cognitive skills using British ability scales and things like those that are reported, that are assessed by the interviewer. So they're not mother reported. They're not affected by this kind of issue. And we have measures of child non-cognitive skills. Interesting, we have sometimes the same measure, so developed, for example, from the Strength and Difficulty Questionnaire, which is this sort of battery of questions about children's social and economic development, and we have the mother kind of, version of it, and as well as the teacher version of it, which is nice because, it sort of, refers to the same kind of domain in some sense. And then sort of we do something a little bit more heroic with interviewer observation. I mean, there is information there about the behavior of the child, because the interviewer spends actually quite a lot of time with the child with these batteries of questions and so on. So he's asked actually in one of the surveys, asked to make an assessment about the behavior of the child. And we try to use all that information, as well as the personal, social, and emotional development component of the FSP at age 5, which is measured by the teachers or reported by the teachers. I'm going to go fast on this. I mean, for parental cognitive skills, we have only basically time-invariant measures, so we're going to assume that those are kind of fixed. And whereas for the non-cognitive skills, we have the mental health measures. They come from the Kessler scale questionnaire, which is asked at every age of the child, as well as things like life satisfaction, happiness, and so on. Parental inputs I'm going to skip because it's too much for this presentation. So you know, I mean, these are the kind of things, the elements in our model. So the cognitive ability of the mother, so everything with the little m at the top is the mother. Everything that doesn't have the m at the top is the child. And so we have basically three basic equations that look at the evolution of child cognitive skill at t plus one as a function of the child cognitive skill at t, as well as the non-cognitive skill of the child at t, the maternal cognitive, which are time invariant, the maternal non-cognitive, right, and a series of investments and so on. And similarly for the child non-cognitive skill, this n, non-cognitive, and the maternal non-cognitive skill, so maternal well-being, if you want, right? So these are the equations for the inputs. I'm not going to talk about inputs in this in this situation. And then obviously there are some kind of identifying restrictions that we need to impose on this model. Otherwise, obviously, we wouldn't be able to estimate anything. So we sort of look at these non-cognitive skills and cognitive skills of the child and the mother as some kind of a latent variable of which we have different kind of measurement, as in, in this sort of literature. What matters here is this following equation, where what we do is that we have the mother-reported, so we have mother-reported measure of the child non-cognitive skills, so these are all the non-cognitive mother-reported measures, and we assume that there is, in the sort of measurement equation for the mother-reported child non-cognitive skills, there is a term here which captures the effect of maternal mental health on, on these measurements, in other words, right? So, which this term here is also, as we have seen, an input in the production function of children's skills. So that is basically where the bias and the issue and the problem arises. And, together with this, we have teacher or interviewer reported measures which are not affected by maternal mental health. Right? And this allows the identification of this bias in some sense. Okay, so just some preliminary analysis that shows that if we just want to correlate, let's go to this one actually, the child non-cognitive skills in the next period, so at T plus one, using basically, these are kind of just basic correlation, using the child cognitive skill, non-cognitive skill at times T and the maternal non-cognitive at time T. So what we see is that if we use I'm going to predict children non-cognitive skill in the next period, and I use the teacher-reported measure of the children non-cognitive skills, I have a sort of persistence parameter that is actually much lower than what I would obtain if I were to use the mother-reported measure of skills. So this is just some kind of initial motivation, depending which measures of non-cognitive skills of the child I use, I would obtain very, very different things depending, in terms of the persistence parameter. The persistence parameter obviously I looked at a lot because it sort of tells me how malleable, the children, non-cognitive skill development is throughout the, question.
Sorry, may I just ask a clarification? Is there a difference in the timing of these interviews? For instance, if the teachers are interviewed later or earlier compared to the mothers? Did you check for that? Because that could be influencing these correlations as well.
The teachers are, 5 minutes. Can we talk about that in a minute? Yeah, because the timing is obviously a factor here. Just go to the main analysis and then maybe come back to that. So in the main analysis, we just put everything together. We estimate this model using the sort of usual identification assumptions and kind of normalizations that are usually done in these kind of situations. And basically, I mean, this is, you know, sort of on the top, we have the outcomes, right? The children cognitive skill at time t plus one, the non-cognitive skills and the maternal well-being or non-cognitive skills, let's say. And what I've highlighted in red are the persistent, the parameters of persistence that we get. So the future in respect of the past value of the skill. And what we see is that, you know, we see quite a high value here. The maternal non-cognitive skills are actually quite persistent over time, so there is relatively, you know, little variation over the course of the time in these skill measures. We see basically that in terms of the child skills, the cognitive skills appear to be more persistent than the non-cognitive skill kind of measure. Sort of to go into a little bit more detail about what we find when we put this to the data, at the moment, as I said, because I mean it's nowhere near to be done. So if we look at the importance, so if we want to sort of think about the importance of the two things that we're, you know, trying to sort of explore here, one is the issue of reporting bias from the mother, and the other one is to recap the the sort of feedback sort of effect kind of issue, whether children's skills affect maternal well-being. So here, if you remember, this is the equation, the measurement equation for children non-cognitive skills when they are mother reported, and there is this gamma here which captures the, you know, how, you know, important in some sense is the bias factor. And as you can see, I mean, it really comes out to be strongly significant. In some sense, you know, sort of more correlated, to the latent factor than actual, you know, measure itself. And then what we did is that to get an idea about this effect is to look at the, sort of do some kind of counterfactual exercise. And we look at situations, so we sort of use the model to simulate what we would get if we were to shut down this gamma, for example. So if we were to ignore the effect of this, you know, the influence of maternal well-being on the measurement, what would we get instead? Because, you know, the model is structural, we can actually obtain these kind of counterfactual estimate. And what we see here is that the model predicts a sort of a larger influence. So the model in sort of here is the model we estimate, and this is the sort of naive model which doesn't take into account this reporting bias. We would take larger influence of child non-cognitive skills, right, on the even the cognitive outcomes. Interestingly, this is the thing that was coming out even from the descriptive kind of analysis, that the persistence of non-cognitive skills for the child, if we were to ignore the bias of mother reporting, would be actually much larger. In other words, because maternal, I mean, an intuition for this is that because we've seen that maternal well-being, in some sense, is very persistent over time, that creates, artificially sort of inflates the persistence of non-cognitive skills of the child. So, you know, what we think that, you know, the process is very, very set, you know, and difficult to shake, whereas, you know, perhaps if we did take into account this bias, we would be able to see more malleability, more leverage for, changing things over there. In terms of the feedback effects, so we do some kind of simulation and construct counterfactual where we shut down the feedback effect, and we find much less of an effect there. So we find relatively small effects of children, sort of maternal well-being on children outcomes, but also, you know, relatively small effects, or if not even negligible, of children sort of development of cognitive and non-cognitive skills on maternal outcomes. So we really do not find a lot of evidence of this effect. So in one area, I think we do say something. In other area, we say, you know, obviously we don't see very much. So just to recap, obviously we sort of interested in this feedback effects and reporting effects, and we sort of covered some evidence in these respects. I think that two positive messages. On the one hand, that if there are no such feedback effects, it's actually very nice, because in some sense we don't have people sort of entering some kind of downward spiral with depression and things like that. So actually it in some sense is a positive message, and also the message about the fact that if we really try to take into account this reporting bias, we find that these non-cognitive skills of the children are more malleable, in some sense less persistent, again is a positive message. We have plans to change this quite radically, because at the moment everything is very linear, whereas we want to move on to a non-linear model, and that obviously requires a time investment that we haven't made right now. But if you have comments or suggestions, I'll take them, but I think I've run out of time. Is that right? Okay, so probably I should stop here, but if you want to talk to me later, then I'll be very happy. Okay, I want to give space to the others.
So we'll have to make up something a bit more original. But for the moment, we are also looking at the link between maternal mental health and child development in lower middle income country settings. And this is truly preliminary work. So these are initial estimates, and this is the point where your feedback will be very useful in shaping this work. This is joint work with Jerry Berman at the University of Pennsylvania and Whitney Strott, who's also there. So our starting point for thinking about this is that if there are adverse intergenerational effects of maternal mental health on child development, as some of the evidence suggests, then it may be a particularly relevant mechanism for intergenerational transmission of poverty in lower middle income countries. And that is because there is evidence of a sort of socioeconomic gradient in stress in general, and there is also evidence of high prevalence of maternal depression and worse mental health in lower middle income countries. So for example, I think the prevalence of maternal depression postpartum, so in the first few months after the birth of a child, in high income countries is around 13%, and in lower middle income countries is around 20%. That's sort of an average across many countries. So if we want to think about policies that may be effective in breaking intergenerational transmission of poverty beyond, say, raising household incomes or parental education, which some new evidence is suggesting is not actually as effective as it was thought to be, then exploring further this channel for the intergenerational transmission seems like an important way to go. So in terms of the evidence that exists, there is a lot of the intergeneration effects of parental characteristics. There is a fair bit on maternal physical health and on parental education. So we do see it, so maternal physical health in particular, there are lots of studies that have just recently, there's a new overview by Almond and co-authors overviewing the literature on in utero and very early in utero shocks to the mother and long-term effects on the children, in utero shocks to the grandmother and long-term effects on the children, and that's kind of a physical health channel. And there's also work that shows links between parental education and child development, various outcomes, education attainment, cognitive skills, behavioral problems. There is much less robust evidence on the effects of maternal psychosocial health, so moving away from the physical health and focusing on the psychosocial health. As Emilia mentioned, there is a large biomedical literature that is looking at this, and actually goes back quite a long way, but it's almost entirely correlational, especially when you're looking at the impact of maternal mental health on child outcomes. Well, measure child outcomes, and especially if you move away from child health and start to look at child cognitive development. The other feature of that literature is that it almost exclusively focuses on perinatal mental, maternal mental health, so pre and post birth, and doesn't really then look at maternal depression or maternal mental health later on in childhood, while the mechanisms that we hypothesize for why maternal mental health would affect child development apply just as much, if not more, at later stages of child development, not just in the first year. There are some new studies that are attempting to address, to come up with more convincing causal estimates, and they tend to address the endogeneity of maternal mental health either through some kind of a shock or using sibling fixed effects. Those are the two methods that are being used in the literature that's using observational data. So they're not that many and they're fairly recent. On top of that, I don't know of any studies that are really looking rigorously at the effects of maternal psychosocial well-being on child development at different stages of childhood. And to the extent that we think inputs have different returns at different stages of childhood, that seems like a relevant question. So what do we do? Specifically, where are we contributing? We're looking at child outcomes beyond early childhood. We're using measures of maternal mental health beyond the perinatal period. We're looking at a lower middle income context. There's generally much less evidence on this in those contexts. And we are exploring the importance of endogeneity in this analysis. So what we do is we look at relationship between maternal stress and child development, health and cognition, so two dimensions, at 4 points in childhood in Peru. And we look at the sensitivity of our estimates to assumptions about endogeneity. I think what we provide fairly unique evidence of is that maternal mental health is associated with child development beyond the immediate postnatal period. That estimates are sensitive to the inclusion of controls, which is not mind-blowing. That seems as expected. But also starting to think about long-term effects of maternal mental health in adolescence, for example, being potentially more severe than in earlier childhood if persistence and skills increases as children get older. And we're starting to think about that. That's really just initial early investigation. So the data we use are the Young Lives. It's the Young Lives data set. This is a cross-national panel study of childhood poverty in 4 countries, in Ethiopia, India, Peru, and Vietnam. And they're collecting extensive data, similar to the Millennium Cohort study, actually. I think that's the most comparable UK data set, on the circumstances in which children grow up and their well-being. So the reason that we only use data for Peru is because Peru was unique in measuring maternal mental health in every round of the data collection. The other 3 countries measured it in the first round and have not done so since. So Young Lives have produced a nice picture of what they do. They started in 2002, they're following 2 cohorts of children, and we're going to focus on this younger cohort of children. So the first round of data collection, these kids were 1, and I'm using the first 4 rounds because this 5th round is currently in the field or just finished. So we have measures for the children ages 1, 5, 8 and 12 for about 2,000 children. The nice thing about these data, and generally panel data sets in developing countries, is that the attrition rates are much, much lower than you will find in developed countries. So this is work done up to the 4th round, so this is the last round we used in 2013, and overall attrition at that point was 6%. So that's I think in the MCS it's significantly higher than that. The other nice feature, in fact, about for all the countries, but for Peru in particular, is that in rounds 3 and 4, there were sibling measurements were added. So in addition to cognitive and health measures of the index child, the child being followed, they also measured in Peru the younger sibling of the child. And the way that the ages match up in Peru in particular, the younger siblings of the child are close in age that the child was in the previous round. And I showed this with the distribution of ages in for the index child in round 2 and for the sibling in round 3. So the index child was 5, so around 5 in round 2, then that's the red line there. And then the siblings are also, they're more spread out, but they're also around the age of 5 in round 2. So what we have is, roughly speaking, sibling age 5 in round 3, index child age 5 in round 2, sibling age 8 in round 4, index child age 8 in round 3. So that gives us a kind of a data set where we can play around with sibling fixed effects as well as age. Our main measures of maternal mental health, it's SRQ-20 instrument. It's a self-reported questionnaire. It's a WHO-recommended instrument for measuring mental distress and neurotic disorders in developing countries. It's not focused on picking up depression. It's a broader measure of mental health and well-being. I refer to it as mental health and stress interchangeably because I use the entire score. I don't use any cutoffs for clinically significant levels of the score. And it was administered to all the mothers of young live children in Peru in each round. It's a 20-question tool. These are the questions, and it's yes or no answers. In the biomedical literature, the score that's used is just the raw score added up, so how many yeses there are. And it's questions from do you often have headaches to do you feel the worthless person, have you thought of ending your life. So there's quite a variety of questions in terms of seriousness. This is the summary statistics for the measure in our data. So the mean score is around 5.6. 5.6 in at age when the children are first surveyed, and then it's lower at subsequent ages. I'm still looking at how that correlates with whether there are other young children in the household. And in terms of what's considered a significant score, so a clinically significant score, which I don't use in the analysis, but to give you an idea of how a psychiatrist would read these data, they would think that about 30% of the mothers in that first round are at high risk of having a common mental disorder. And that goes down to about 12, 10, and 20% in the other rounds. Thinking about this first round, which is really a postnatal period, so the average in developing countries seems to be around 20%, but we have a pro-poor sample, so this is fairly consistent, and there we would expect these rates to be higher. Here I'm just showing that the sibling sample, this is the subsample of kids for whom we also have sibling data, which is about a quarter of the sample, looks fairly similar in terms of the maternal mental health measures. In terms of the measures of child development, we use long-term health measure, height for AZ score. And for cognitive development, we have two measures. One is the Peabody Picture Vocabulary Test. That's a measure of receptive vocabulary, and it's administered at ages 5, 8, and 12. And we also have an assessment of general mathematical competency, which is administered also at ages 5, 8, and 12. For the siblings, we only have PPDT. We don't have the maths. And the maths is not comparable between ages 5 and 8, whereas the PPDT is the same test that's being administered every round. So our strategy, we assume that variation in maternal stress is likely to be non-random, and it's likely to be related to factors that also impact child development, whether they're genetic factors or environmental factors. What we're not trying to do is come up with a set of estimates and argue that they're causal. I think instead what we're trying to do is see how far we can push these unusually rich data to estimate multiple models and see how sensitive the correlations between maternal mental health and child development are. So causal, in a sense, causal interpretation of these estimates within each of the model hinges on different assumptions about endogeneity. And the sensitivity of the estimates may tell us something about the importance of unobserved factors and what kinds of unobserved factors. So in addition to providing, I think, new evidence on the associations between maternal mental health and child development, we're also trying to get at this issue of, well, how important is endogeneity, which is not really being dealt with in the majority of this literature. So what we do is we estimate, at the moment, four models. The first is just simple bivariate correlations between maternal stress and child development. We then add observed controls, and these include child sex, ethnicity, age, characteristics of the mother and father, education, whether they're living in the household, household size and wealth. We're then able to add, in some of the models, lagged outcome measures. So that should control any unobserved inputs in child endowments to the extent that they work through the lagged outcome. So we look at the effect of maternal depression on PPVT at age 8, controlling for PPVT at age 5. And that should absorb quite a lot of unobserved heterogeneity. And finally, we use the sibling data to estimate a maternal fixed effects model. This is just to say that we can't estimate all the models for all the ages. Obviously, sometimes we have a lagged outcome, sometimes we don't. At age 1, we don't have the lag measures. The most complete models can be estimated for age 8, when we have the sibling data and we have lagged outcome measures. So this is the first set of results. These are preliminary estimates. This is looking at the correlation between maternal mental health and height for age Z scores at ages 1, 5, 8, and 12. So for each of these ages, we're using a contemporaneous maternal mental health measure. We use a raw score, but we also use a first factor score to the extent that different items discriminate between latent mental health differently, that measure should be more efficient. And I think the striking thing about the health results, in the literature these results are fairly mixed. Some studies find significant correlations, some studies find insignificant. What we find is that for all ages, with the exception of age 8, the bivariate correlations are significant. There's a negative effect of negative association between maternal mental health and height for age Z scores, so child growth. And it's in the range of 0.1 of a standard deviation, so which is actually a very small effect. Once we add controls, though, they disappear in all cases. So even just adding the set of observed controls in the next step model, where we add a very basic set of controls, these correlations become insignificant. So to me, the mixed results in the literature suggest that these correlations are actually very sensitive to the kinds of controls that are being included, and that may be why we're finding this very mixed results. One argument could be that actually, because we're looking at a long-term measure of health, we should be looking at lagged measures of maternal stress on growth. So here, the maternal depression measure is from the previous period. So for age 5, the maternal depression measure is from age 1, and for ages 8 and 12, they're for age 5 and 8. And here we get a little bit more action on the youngest children. So we seem to be getting a fairly robust negative association between maternal mental health and child growth. This actually I estimated today, so I'm still kind of working through it. But certainly for later ages, we're not getting any significant associations once we add some controls. For cognitive measures of cognitive development, we're getting quite different results. Again, the bivariate correlations, with the exception of age 8 for PPVT, are significant. There's a negative association between maternal mental health and language, child language development. Once we add in controls, that persists but is significantly smaller in size. And our sibling fixed effects estimates, while they are not significant, they're not significantly different from the models with observed controls or lagged outcomes. They're attenuated down, which is what you would expect given that measurement error is amplified in these. So the pattern we're getting is that there seems to be a negative association, especially in earlier childhood, in the order of magnitude of about 0.5% of a standard deviation. So one standard deviation increase in maternal maternal stress is associated with 5% of a standard deviation decrease in language development. For quantitative skills, the effects come through a bit later. So they seem to be strongest in adolescence. So the negative correlations persist in all of our models. But again, the addition of controls, especially with a lagged outcome, the magnitude of the association goes down, and again is around 5% of a standard deviation. To wrap up, I think that clearly controls, what sort of adjustments you make, what controls are included, matters. And this may explain some of the inconsistencies that are being found in the biomedical literature. What I think is quite striking is how similar the estimates across the adjusted models are. So whether you include just observed controls, or you include the lagged outcome as well, or even sibling fixed effects, there's not a huge change in the conclusions that we draw. Our preliminary conclusions are that there is more evidence of a relationship between maternal mental health and child development for cognitive development than for health, and that it seems to be around language development, the effects seem to come through more, the associations are stronger in early childhood, whereas for quantitative skills in adolescence. The effects are quite small, strikingly small. And in fact, in the literature in general, when effects are reported, they're fairly small. I think a direction to think in is, what are the long-term effects? And here we have the opportunity to look at long-term effects by looking at this lagged outcome model. So we could, if we assume that this is the true persistence parameter, then we can calculate the long-term effects. And for example, for the quantitative, the effect on quantitative skills at age 12, as persistence in skills increases, is in fact double the size that the short-term effect is. Now, the problem with interpreting the persistence parameter is that we have a problem of measurement error and the problem of unobserved heterogeneity. So how we parse those out, there's a literature around that. And whether we can take this long-term analysis any further is something we're working on. We also have the data, I think, to look at mechanisms, even if descriptively, because we have, there is data on maternal aspirations and some data on parental investments. And actually, maternal aspirations is one of the hypothesized channels for how maternal depression or stress may affect child development. So there's, that's kind of the next step in this analysis. Thank you.
Running quite late, so I'm going to give the floor to Paulina, but if anybody has got questions for Sonia, I think it'd be nice to continue the conversation at the coffee break.
Right, so thanks for coming. Before I get started, I just wanted to state again that Sonia, sorry she couldn't make it today. She has some problem with her knee. But I'll try my best to deliver the message. This joint with Sonia is a work by Victoria, Baranov, and Joanna, Maselko. And what we're going to be looking at is at mental health or woman depression can affect a woman's financial empowerment. We're going to be looking at this using RCT that took place in Pakistan. Now, the question we are assessing is whether maternal depression can have a sustained and persistent impact on women's financial empowerment. We're going to be using experimental variation in the maternal depression from this RCT. So we're going to be looking at a sample of women that were diagnosed as being depressed in the last trimester of pregnancy. I'm going to be explaining a little bit more what is this intervention about, but as John was saying before, this is cognitive behavioral therapy. And we're going to be looking at the effects of this intervention at follow-up dates of 1 year and 6 years later, 7 years from the child's birth. So a little bit on results, where we see that the CBT intervention had persistent benefits for both health, especially at year one, but also these effects on the intervention persisted 7 years later, and there was a reduction in the incidence of maternal depression from 31 to 25%. I'm also going to explain a little bit more on what are our measures for financial empowerment, but we see some improvements in the labor supply of mothers 6 years later of the intervention, and also an increased control of the spending. So last Friday, the World Health Organization devoted the World Health Day to raise awareness on depression. And not only a large share of the population lives with depression nowadays, but this number has increased by 18% from 2005 to 2015. Another motivation to look at depression is that these psychosocial competencies are could be considered as an element of a human capital influencing labor market outcomes. There is also research pointing towards the effect of mental health on losses on productivity and increase of the incidence of crimes. There are also been studies pointing towards creation and perpetuation of poverty traps. And although there is clinical evidence that the CBT interventions can have an impact on depression status, very little is known about its effects on the long run, and more specifically, not much on maternal depression, but rather overall mental health. Actually, maternal depression is estimated to be at around 12 to 20% in OECD countries, and this share is much higher in developing countries due to especially higher poverty, stress, stress from low economic resources, and also from high fertility rates that in the end just increases the risk of exposure. It very often goes undiagnosed and hence untreated, and Mills and Jenkins just point some factors of being depressed in Pakistan and somewhere else as in female of a low income household and low education or low social support. There have also been studies linking with weak financial autonomy in rural Asia and impacting productivity and investment in children and human capital. So all in all, we believe there is a huge potential if a low-cost, positive thinking therapy can have an effect on women's mental health and also, in the end, also affect financial autonomy. So when one thinks of what channels could depression affect women's empowerment, we could probably think of preferences and constraints. In preferences would have the to afford, or how some stress and fatigue can raise the cost to accept the afford. Discounting, if like a catastrophic view of the future, can lead to inconsistent intertemporal choices, and also, as someone pointed out, these expectations of learning about the returns, and constraints will have disposable time if depression leads to sick days or tight and time constraints. And we could also think of depression affecting productivity and the bargaining power women have in maybe the household and not only in the young. So this thinking healthy program, basically what it did was to screen over 4,000 women in the third trimester of pregnancy, of which about 22% were diagnosed as clinically depressed and were included in the trial. Now, this diagnosis was done by professional psychiatrists, and it was done following diagnostic and statistical mental disorders that is not specific to maternal depression, but is the standard way of assessing major depressive episodes in general. Now, the randomization was done at the Union Council level, which is the lowest geopolitical unit in Pakistan, and we're going to be having 20 union councils as treated and 20 as controls. Now, the intervention was delivered by lady health workers. They were community-based and were purposefully trained for the occasion. We're going to have that both arms, treatment and control, received 16 home visits by these health workers over a span period of 11 months, consisting of enhance routine care for the child, but the differential component of the treating the depression intervention was that women in the treated group, in addition, received this cognitive behavioral therapy that I'll be explaining a little bit what is it about. But Raman et al. In 2008 estimated that this intervention costed under $10 per woman and year, and led to a recovery of 3 out of 4 women treated in the first year postpartum. So this study is gonna. So these 16 visits were spread in the first third year. Like there were weekly visits for the last 4 weeks before pregnancy. It was followed by 3 visits in the first postnatal month, and then 1 visit thereafter. We're going to be following this woman at 6 months, 12 months, and this study uses data from that went back to Pakistan and gathered at least 7 years information on health measures and its financial and empowerment measures. And this study was able to locate about 83% of this woman, of this mother-child diets, the person at day one, so that's quite high. And in addition, 300 mother-child diets of those women that were not diagnosed as being depressed at best, and were contacted to compare levels in this three dimensions. So, very briefly, this cognitive behavioral therapy, it uses techniques for active listening and guided discovery of healthy behavior. It basically turns to, turn all this negative thinking into positive thinking, and it focuses on identifying, modifying these cognitive distortions on how mothers see themselves on their child and their relations with others. They were also given some pictorial and verbal messages to keep with them. And this was one of the largest trials in the developing world on the issue. And the World Health Organization adopted in 2015 this Thinking Healthy program as evidence-based practice. So because this is a randomized experiment, the identification strategy is pretty straightforward. We have D, which is an indicator of whether the women were living in a treaty cluster. It is a set of controls that include maternal mental health at baseline, including the Hamilton, the brief disability questionnaire, the multi-social perceived support, maternal social perceived support, and also includes the mother's age, square, parity, mother's and father's education, family structure, grandmother present. Also in some slides that are kind of coming up, you're going to be seeing maybe phrased as mother-in-law, because 90% of these grandmothers were the mother of the husband, and also includes PCA-weighted, asset-based wealth index, household income, and interest rate. Also, it's going to be controlled for this multiple hypothesis testing, controlling the family-wise error rate. And we're going to be looking at effects on multiple outcomes. So we're going to be constructing this Anderson index of 2008, which is going to give more weight to those outcomes that will provide more unique information. So just to have a view of how this intervention affected maternal depression, as can be seen, for the 6 month follow-up and 1 year follow-up, the incidence of maternal depression was quite large between controls and group of around 33 percentage points. However, at the 7 year follow-up, we see how there was this spontaneous recovery from the control group, which in the end it means there's some power loss to detect effects at 7 years. So in addition of a binary outcome of being depressed or not depressed, we're also going to be using the number of depressive symptoms, the extent to which these symptoms affect distress or impair or affect the ability to carry on regular activities. Also some recall data on the depression episodes 2 years prior to the interview, about 7 years. And also going to be paying some attention to the perceived social support. So in order to interpret the results, I'm coming up to saying that this index is constructed such in a way that positive outcomes are associated to the positive values are associated with positive outcomes, and standardized so that control group is in 0 and standard deviation 1. So as We saw improvements at 1 year, the intervention improved the mental health index by 0.73 standard deviations, and that you know, accounts for a reduction in 33 percentage points in the instance of maternal depression. It also improved along the dimension of these other measures. But however, at year seven, the magnitude of this effect is down to 0.3 standard deviations, and this accounts for like 7 percentage points difference from the region.
Now, one can think that some mothers might have benefited more than others from this intervention. Now, we're going to be paying attention to this, the concept of being vulnerable. So we're going to try to predict being depressed at our follow-up years using baseline characteristics. And for example, from this table, we see that depression severity at baseline is an indicator of being depressed later on, mostly in the short run. There's also a bit of wealth effect protecting from depression. But mostly, what we're interested in is the effects in the long run. In the long run, we see that only this social support is providing some evidence as being able to protect or reduce the incidence of maternal depression in the long run. So the treatment is actually deferred by these vulnerability measures, and the answer is yes. We have that in line with our previous results, depression severity. Women with high depression severity benefit more from the treatment. And similarly, we could interpret these results in both ways. So women with a higher perceived social support benefited less, or women that had perceived as being lower social support benefited more from the intervention. And similarly, those mothers that were living with a mother-in-law or so in an extended family benefited less from the intervention. So if we look at this mental health index closely at 7 years, we saw before that the overall impact on mental health was of 0.3 standard deviation. But if we look at these heterogeneous effects by being high or having a high or low social support at baseline, we see that women that we consider that had high support based were women that were living with their grandmothers and their mothers in another household. So no effect from the intervention, and in fact all the effects come from these women for which were on their own taking care of their kids. And the intervention reduced 14 percentage points in the incidence of maternal depression. So now we're going to move on to talk about how this effect on mental health affected women's financial autonomy. Just quickly saying that we saw a big effect at year one, persistent effects, although smaller at 7 to 6 years. We do some robustness tests, changing different controls, this difference in different specification, but we also include in the estimation this non-depressed woman at baseline, pretty much stays consistent. And I will also keep in mind that the treatment benefited vulnerable mothers more, and especially over time. So this financial empowerment index is going to be composed of mother's employment, her earnings, and whether she has control over spending in the household. And we see that in fact the intervention did improve financial autonomy index 6 years after intervention, or the follow-up 7 years, by 0.22 standard deviations. This is coming from an increase of 9 percentage points of the control over spending. Now, if we think again of these heterogeneous effects on the treatment had on different set of women, again, we see no effect on financial empowerment or financial autonomy for those women that were living with the grandmother of the child. And in fact, for those women that we consider had low social support at baseline, we see also an effect now on the labor supply and the increase on control over spending. It's also larger to 17 percentage points.
Now, well, one thinks of the mechanism that could be driving these results beyond. So we talked about these direct effects of preferences and constraints, but there could have been also indirect effects. We could think of, for example, the household wealth. There was some economic effects via carriers, or the woman's physical health. Maybe the treatment could have affected the fertility trajectories of this woman by spacing birth or lowering the number of children they had in the future, or child mortality or child quality. It could also have affected the relationship woman had with their husband or with the mother-in-law, that could have led to an increase in bargaining power. And also there could have been some increased social support if some grandmothers moved in the house, or some of this woman reached out for help for others. So in terms of child quality, there's limited evidence that this intervention was able to increase by 0.22 standard deviations the health of the child. And about the rest of the outcome, we see the intervention had no effect at all on husband's income trajectory, nor mother's physical health, and on fertility trajectory. And what we see is that the cognitive behavioral therapy had an effect on the quality of the relationship the mother had with the husband and the mother-in-law, and also the presence or trajectory of the mother-in-law. So this basically is capturing what's the intensity by which this woman were living with the grandmother of the child. So this is just a graph to show that there's no differences in fertility trajectories. And now I'm just going to be showing some mediation analysis, but we could think of it as descriptives. Everything is endogenous. We're not instrumented for anything. And basically, we see that of about 10% of the effect of the treatment could be explained by the improvement on the relationship quality, and but mostly of this effect that we saw on mental health and financial autonomy is coming directly from an improvement in mental health. So to wrap up, I'm going to say that we see that there are persistent and long-term benefits of the CBT intervention, especially for mothers with low social support. This intervention improved women's financial autonomy, more specifically the employment and bargaining power within the household, and again, especially among the most vulnerable group. From the last picture, we see this modest financial empowerment is unlikely to be a result of indirect mechanisms, but rather that it responded as a consequence of the increase in mental health. To the author's knowledge, this is the first experimental evidence that is linking depression and economic decision-making in the long run. So, thanks.